It's time to speak up.
It's time to speak out.
Welcome to We Have a Voice.
Community discussions about Huntington's disease
and juvenile Huntington's disease.
Show host, James Valvano.
You are loved.
Welcome to We Have a Voice Radio. I'm Leanne Delong, and I'm going to be your host for this evening. We are broadcasting through iHeartRadio, Sprecher, YouTube, Spotify, and other networks. I'm actually going to talk to Kevin Jess, the regular show host tonight. We're having kind of an impromptu late-night chat, and I think Kevin is going to share a little bit of his experience dealing with genetic testing. Kevin, why don't you tell us your story?
Sure, Leanne. I, as a matter of fact, I was just sitting here, you know, thinking, and there's a reason why this is playing on my mind this evening, because my son Malachi has, has been tested for Huntington's disease, and we are now waiting on for that to happen, and so I think that what I'll do is I'll go back a little bit, go back in time to bring up to why this is a bit, I don't know what you call it, why it's really weighing on me. It's like history repeats itself, it seems, a lot of times. And when I go back and I look at the problems that we had with getting my wife tested, and then jumping forward to today, it's ringing so familiar to me, and when I think back and I'm going, you know, my wife never wanted to be tested, but I just at some point in time you get to that point in your life where you're sick enough that you need to be tested, and I like, for instance, I couldn't get anybody in to help, like, you know, medically, like I couldn't get like the VON, the Victorian Order of Nurses, or anybody to come in to help out with that, because she would just tell them to go away. Now, if I had had her tested and then they finally recognized that she had, this disease, then I would have been able to possibly take over, in the sense of getting some kind of authority so that I could have someone come in to help. And that simply wasn't going to happen. At one point, I was able, she was showing some, that day she happened to be showing signs of clarity, and I thought, I'm going to go and ask her if she would get tested. And on that particular day, it was early in the morning, and on that particular day, she said, yes, I think I will. So I called the doctor's office immediately, because I knew that these times are fleeting. And he did up a requisition. We went into the hospital. They took her blood. She did refuse at that point to have her blood taken, but I said, give me a couple minutes. I talked to her, and she said, okay, I'm fine with it. Let's do this. But then they sent her blood, because what they do here is they take it at our local hospital, and then they send it to the IWK Health Sciences Center in Halifax to the genetics department, where they would do a genetic test. And they called me, and they were saying, we can't do this test unless we have informed consent. But she didn't want to do that, because that meant that she was going to have to talk to somebody. She's going to have to sort of face it. And she didn't want that. She just wanted the test done and be over with. She didn't want to talk about it. So, that ended that. No way would they test. And, I had taken her in to see a psychiatrist, and I wanted him to, see about deeming her incompetent to make these kinds of choices. And because she was incompetent. She could not make these choices for herself. And so they ask you three questions to determine competence here in Nova Scotia. That is, what's your name? Where are you? And what day is it? She knew her name. She didn't know what day it was. She didn't even know what season it was. She didn't know exactly where she was. She didn't know, because this was done at the hospital. She didn't exactly know, but he would prompt her. And anyway, he asked her a lot more questions than that. And most of them she couldn't answer, but he deemed her competent. So I was left, couldn't get the test. So now jump ahead. Now her blood has been sent there to the IWK. They have it. What I didn't know was that they would keep that for a long period of time. So jump ahead 8 years. She is now nonverbal at that point. She was late stage, and she was palliative. And they had told us that she would die. And I said, I need this test done. I need to establish this because I have three children. And I just needed that, not to mention the fact that she didn't want to get tested because so many people told her there was nothing wrong with her. Her family were telling her this and saying, there's nothing wrong with you. And so I needed that proof that yes, she had Huntington's disease, and why anybody would doubt it is beyond me. Her own doctor didn't doubt it. It was, and there was nothing he could do. His hands were tied on it. And but nevertheless, that same psychiatrist came in. He hummed and hawed about it. She's laying there on her deathbed at that point. And he says, well, I don't know. She's nonverbal. She's in pretty bad shape. She's probably not going to live. So I'm going to deem her incompetent. And so at that point, I was able to have her tested, and she was positive, and with a CAG of 46. So now, that took 8 years for that to happen. And now, jumping ahead, it's been 10 years since that original blood was taken from her. And they used that original blood, by the way, that she had taken 8 years previously. That's what they used for that blood test. I didn't realize they would do that. I thought they would just take another blood sample. But they didn't. They used the original blood. And, but like I say, now jump ahead. And my son, who is 19, now he has been exhibiting symptoms for some time. You can jump and say, I know exactly what it is, and probably I do that. But they were symptoms that someone who with Huntington's disease would have. Okay? And it wasn't just one. There were several. And I had discussed it with him and so on. And now, for the past few years, he had been also helping me. I had to work, so he would help with his mother. You name it, he was doing it, and with no help. So you've got a young person here who's doing all those little details that you do for someone who is bedridden. And and of course it was causing problems with school, and they were not the least bit understanding of that. And so they de-enrolled him. They
really?
Yes. They told him he was a liar. And even though they knew, because I had told them, like, can't you do something as educators? Can't you do something to help this young man get through this? This is a hard time. I have to work. Okay, I can't get anybody to come into the home to help us. And so on certain days, I work shift work, so 12-hour shifts. So I would. It was the days that were the problem. And because he's going to be here in the nights anyway. But when there were days, I would have to have him be here with his mother. I had to. I had no choice. But they didn't care. They just simply de-enrolled him. And he was an intelligent young man. There's nothing wrong with him as far as learning goes. He had lots of friends. He's, you know, he liked basketball and playing video games, just a normal young teenager, right? And anyway, but the symptoms were there. So we had asked about it, but they said, well, we don't test for anybody under 18 years of age. And so we waited. Now he's 19. He could probably gone through this at 18, but you know, one thing led to another, and we just didn't. And then he decided that yes, he wanted to go through with testing. He had had a session with Dr. Lang, and you know, and Dr. Lang was very good, and basically said, you know, obviously we don't know for sure without a blood test, but if you asked me if your son could have Huntington's disease, I would say, yes, he could have Huntington's disease because he has symptoms, but that would have to be tested and to find out for sure, which is obvious. You know, you can't just make a judgment call like that and say, oh, you've got it, you know, and he did not do that. So we went into our family doctor, and he told our doctor, I want to get tested for Huntington's disease. So our doctor said, okay. So he wrote out the requisition and sent us to the hospital, which is right next door to his office. And we went right down. And that's where the problem started. They told us right at the desk where we take the requisition that particular test was something that our family doctor could not order. So, and I'm like, well, what do you mean? Like, he's a doctor. You know, no, that particular test now has to be done by a neurologist. It has to be ordered by a neurologist. Well, that wasn't the case with my wife. This is just another thing to... Now, there's only one neurologist here. So to get an appointment with that neurologist is going to be... I mean, this is Nova Scotia. We have a population of less than 1 million in this whole province. And it's a tiny place, as you know, Leanne. It's just not... Nova Scotia's not very big. And
no, you're right.
Yeah. And so, you know, we have specialists. They're here. Yeah. But there's not a lot of them because we just don't have the population. And in the valley here, there's only one. So, and I believe he serves Valley South Shore and southwestern Nova Scotia. So I think he's got this huge area, and it's going to take a long time to get in to see him. It's over a year. So that's just no good. So I said, we just need the blood taken. Just take the blood. Right? So I'm quite forceful in when I'm talking to these people, and I'm gonna get probably what I want. But so they did. They took the blood. And of course they sent it to the lab downstairs, and our doctor's office got a phone call that they were going to reject the blood. That was the end of that.
For what purpose, though?
They said it's because a neurologist didn't order it.
Okay. So you technically have to just go through the IWK in Halifax.
Well, basically what you have to do is you have to get a referral from your family doctor to go to a neurologist. All right. So what our doctor did is he told the lab, well, okay, I'm making a referral, so just send the blood to the IWK. They said, okay. They did it. So it gets down there, and he gets an email from the IWK saying they were rejecting the blood because it wasn't coming from a neurologist's order, and they would not test it. And so anyway, I said, well, I don't know what to do at this point. So I called them, and they said, well, you know, this is predictive testing, and so it's really not something that we, you know, have to do right away, da da da. And I said, no, this is not predictive testing. He has symptoms. And they said, but didn't you just say he was 19? And I said, yes, he's 19. Oh, well, there's no possible way he could have symptoms at 19. So don't worry about it.
Don't tell me they were that naive.
That's what they told me. Yeah.
Oh, boy.
And, yeah. And now, I mean, he has symptoms of OCD. He has some swallowing issues. There's like pain is like dystonia in his legs. There's several symptoms that he has, and anxiety, you know, these are typical symptoms of someone with HD. And now it could be other things, but without a test for HD, which would be automatic, because they even had his file attached to his mother's. They've got his mother's file. His file was attached to hers, so they knew that his mother had Huntington's disease. They already knew that. And but yet they were still turning it down. So what I did is I called our MLA, and I guess for listeners in the United States, our MLA, so that would be the equivalent of your state representative who your state legislature. And in Canada, it's called an MLA, Minister of Legislative Assembly. And he represents our area in this county of Nova Scotia. And he said, well, I really don't, it was something that he wanted to hear because he's in the opposition. So, you know, it gave him something to go for. So he told us that failing being able to get a test, that he would invite us to the legislature where he would ask the Minister of Health, why is it that he can't get tested? So after that, we heard very little. All of a sudden, I get a call from his office. It was his assistant, and she said, the IWK is wondering if you had tried to have him tested previous to being 18. And to be honest with you, I had no idea why they would even ask that question.
Okay.
But they did, and I said, well, no, because I was told that he couldn't be tested until after he was 18. And so we didn't do that. So that's what the answer was that went back. So then we heard nothing for quite a while. And so I had called the IWK on several occasions, and every time I call them, I get so worked up. It just infuriates me to the point where I just want to reach out and touch somebody, you know? And I said, tell me something. If this was your son, what would you do? And she says, well, I can't answer that question. They're the most unfeeling people I've ever seen. So I waited a few more weeks thinking that we were going to hear something, because February the 28th was when the legislature opens, and I knew that we had been invited by our MLA to go there to be in the legislature personally, and I still hadn't heard anything. So February the 28th came and went, and I heard nothing. So I called, knowing, because they don't answer our phone. They're, like, when we call, they don't answer. So I left a message, and a couple of days later, they called back and they asked for my son, because they won't talk to me because he's 19, so he's an adult. They don't want to talk to me. And so they put him on the phone. I put him on the phone, and he says, but you won't test me, so I'm wondering, you know, what do I do at this point? You know, and she says, what do you mean we won't test you? Of course we'll test you. But it's going to be, you're going to be put on a waiting list, and it doesn't matter that he was symptomatic. So if you're symptomatic, you should be pushed up on that list, right? No, they still, it was predictive testing as far as they were concerned. So they said it could be 2020 or 2021. But they put on, so what they've done, obviously, they must have, and I'm just surmising this, is that they've told the MLA that they're going to test. And so he backed off because he thought it's solved. He's not digging deeper. He's a busy man, right? And, but anyway, we decided that we just don't want to wait. And we don't want to wait that long. And so we're getting to today, why this impromptu meeting, right? And what we had done is we had made, after talking with Dr. Lang and so on, we had made a decision that we would be tested, or he would be tested in Germany. And it seems incredible that we have this healthcare system here that is wonderful. I thank God for our healthcare system every day. But here I am, one of these people that have to go elsewhere for something as small as a blood test for Huntington's. And so right now, I think probably his blood is on a plane over the Atlantic on its way to Germany to be delivered to a lab in Germany tomorrow. And we will have test results within 2 weeks. And so I'm antsy. I'm, you know. I'm feeling.
Yeah, it sounds like you're coming to an end of a very long journey. Kevin, can I ask, what kind of an emotional toll has this taken on you?
Well, I've aged a lot. I've aged badly. No, I really have. Like, I am 56 years old, but, you know, if I told someone that I was 75, they would believe me. You know?
Yeah.
It has taken everything, every part of me, it has ripped me, and it has done. And you know what? I know that there's a lot of people out there who have similar stories, and you know, they may not have had problems testing, they may have, but you know what? They're going through. We're all going through very similar things, and I know everybody's story's different, but there are similarities. And so, You know, and I'm not, my situation is probably no worse than somebody else's, okay, because it's all relative. If it's happening to you, it's the worst. Okay, it just is. And this is my story, right? And to me, it's the worst. You know, I it just is. There's nothing worse than waiting on, for a test for your child that could be very detrimental. There's just nothing. We don't want that to happen to our children. We don't want anything to happen to them. And I look at my other kids too, that there may be issues. I don't know. And but I do know that he has some issues. And you know, and the thing is, he's great. You know, he's here and he's great, and I don't know what I'd do without him. And you know, so having this happen, for them to deny health care, okay, is it adds so much to an already horrible, stressful situation. It shouldn't be that way. It should be streamlined so that, I mean, or at least they should educate themselves on what this actually does to families. You know,
now what happened to the referral from your doctor to the neurologist? Did that ever go through, or did that never make it anywhere?
No, it never. I'm sure he made the referral, but like I say, it's in a pile because we only have one. You know,
right, okay.
We have not. Once he gets there, we would probably get a phone call saying, "Come," and it'll be probably 5 or 6 weeks. You know, and then you would go and see the neurologist. Okay. Now, I'm thinking that with a diagnosis, that might speed up a little bit.
So in 2 weeks, when the results come in, are you feeling like you're going to be relieved from this whole thing? Or do you think it's going to pile on more stress on your end?
Well, no, I mean, my son Malachi and I have, I mean, we talk about this every day it's brought up, okay? Not always by me. Actually, most of the time it's him that brings it up. And he's very anxious, for this to happen. He wants this test. He's not upset or anything about it. He is not looking at it as, you know, oh, we're looking through a crystal ball and this is, and something bad's going to happen to me. There's none of that. Okay. He thinks that for everything that there's an answer to it, that you can maybe even use it to better things, that maybe it might even be easier for him to fill out, you know, a bucket list that we all have, you know, things that he wants to do. He just needs it. And he's come to that conclusion that, you know, from school to the health system to all of it has failed him. Every bit of it, he's been failed on every level. And just because they could, there was no reason for that to happen. None. They did it, and it was purposeful. I see other people, they get tests, and it's like 2 weeks, it's 3 weeks. I was looking on it tonight. So there was somebody on there, I put a post on, and it said, you know, how long did it take you to get your test? And I see people, the most I saw was 3 months in those answers, right? I'm thinking, how the heck did they do that? How do, you know, and right now, like, I have a huge hate on for all of these departments and people who absolutely refused to do anything on our behalf to try and make these things happen. I mean, I have special names for them, you know?
Maybe let's not say them on air, but do you feel it's the Nova Scotia healthcare system in particular, or do you feel this may be across Canada?
Well, they're telling me, according to the IWK, they said they go by the standards and the policies, okay, of other health boards across the country. And I'm thinking, I don't think they do. Because if I look and I see how all these people who got tested and they're saying 2 weeks, these are Canadians. A lot of these were Canadians, right?
Yeah, Nova Scotia is the health. They're very understaffed in the hospitals and in every department. It's ridiculous and unfortunate. And as a journalist, when I used to live there, I remember running countless stories of a shortage of doctors in rural areas, you know, nurse practitioners not being able to stay where they want to stay just because they were trying to help out patients and maybe they crossed the line that, you know, they technically can't cross, but it was in a good way. I've seen and heard everything over the years. And now living here in Alberta, the wait times in an ER are not, like, there's nothing to complain about out here. But, and when it comes to Huntington's doctors, like whether it's a Huntington psychiatrist or you see somebody at the movement disorder clinic, I feel like there's more resources where I am now compared to in Nova Scotia. So that's why I asked if you felt it was more of a rural issue, I guess.
Well, I mean, the thing is, it doesn't matter where you live in Nova Scotia, okay, as far as, I mean, all of it goes to the IWK for testing.
Oh, right.
Okay.
Right, right.
So, and the IWK Health Sciences Center is, I believe it's the biggest hospital in Nova Scotia. I mean, it's in the city. It's, you know.
It probably is, yeah.
Yeah, and everything's done there, right? And so I can't blame my local rural hospital, which is, I mean, it's a fairly large hospital. I mean, it's a regional hospital. So it looks after the whole valley here. And so I'm not blaming that. The worst thing that would really bothers me is the attitude. It's like you feel like you don't matter, you know?
And yeah, I know how that feels,
you know, well, what are they saying? You're going to die anyway. So what the hell? We don't care. You know, I mean, that's how it feels. And, you know, and I realize that that they have to be a little bit impersonal. They have to, you know, sort of take a step back and whatever. I get that. But, you know, I can walk into my doctor's office like I did yesterday to drop off a blood sample. Okay. And because basically what we had to do is we had to go to the Kempville Hospital, have another blood sample taken, two vials, and mail those to Germany. So the doctor's office had, I mean, they had all the stuff ready for me. They everything was done and all in order. And so when I took it up there, I said, okay, so I've got this. I didn't seal the box because you got to put this, do this, do this. And FedEx came to pick it up, and suddenly, you know, it was gone. But when I dropped that off, the receptionist come right around the counter to hug me. And I thought, gee whiz, that made me actually feel like somebody actually cared. You know?
Aww.
Right? It was probably the nicest thing that could have happened at that point in time, because that's, I don't care who you are, it's stressful to go in and do a Huntington's test. That's a that's stressful stuff right there. Okay? So they need to streamline this a little bit. They need to streamline it and make it so that it, that you're not causing, I mean, I thought, don't they have a thing where they do no harm? You know, doctors have to do that? Like, isn't that something that they do? They say, they make a vow, do no harm or something? Well, this is harmful. You know?
It's very stressful, whether you're getting the, you know, the regular genetic test just to know, or whether you have a child that you have to speed the test up for. Going through the experience, you need compassion and you need empathy from the healthcare professionals around you. And it is very unfortunate. Sometimes it is just not there. So, I mean, you're an advocate for Huntington's. Kevin, I'm curious, what changes would you encourage or like to see regarding this whole thing?
I think that when you are in a Huntington's family, I think that you have to give, that medical professionals need to give credit to people who are going in from those families to get tested, that they might know a thing or two. Okay? They should ask you, are you from a Huntington's family and have you been exposed to someone who has Huntington's disease for any length of time? And that question would tell them about how able you are to give informed consent or whether it's needed at all. And that might speed up the process for a lot of people. Or it might, a lot of people don't want to go through all those hurdles. There's too many hurdles. I mean, they're saying, okay, we have, if and when they ever call to have this test done in Nova Scotia, we would have to go to Wolfville, which is not too far from here. There's a clinic there where they have like an electronic visit, cameras and whatever, and you talk to the geneticist in Halifax via like Skype or whatever, okay? And you give informed consent with that meeting. Well, just to have that, it takes, what they tell us, I think it was 4 to 5 weeks before you can get an appointment to do that. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And then they may or may not test your blood. You might have to go in for, to see a counselor and talk about it some more. It's almost like it's discouraged. And I don't think that they need to be discouraging people with Huntington's disease from having a test.
I remember when I went for genetic testing, they actually had me, kind of consult and they want to make sure that you know what you're getting into, and that if you need therapy, if you want to talk about it and all that stuff, the resources are there for people who may need it or want it. But it's a slow process. If you do it like just the general way, not in the emergency way that you should have had it done for your son,
yeah.
But in the general way, yeah, it's very long and it's a drawn out process, which is the most stressful part about the whole thing. Once you get the results, you just move on. Or I did anyway. Not everybody is the same, but yeah.
Yeah, and that's the way it's going to be here. Once we have the results, we'll move on. Okay, but because I can tell by his attitude and that the way he discusses it that no, he's not going to be overly upset about it. I mean, you're not going to be happy about it, but I can't see, this is not going to create any extra problems for him. And so I just feel that they need to streamline things better. I think that they need to give credit to people who because let's face it, it's stressful growing up in a Huntington's household for many people, and it certainly mm-hmm. was for him. You know, he had a lot to do with caring for his mother, and sometimes it's not just caring for it, but it's dealing with it. You know, it can be difficult for some people. Okay,
right.
You know the psychological issues and things that happen, and I think he deserves a lot more credit than what they're giving him, and that instead of putting hurdles, they need to clear a path, and say yes, you need this, and in order for him to move on, and make a life for himself, and so on that. He needs to do this for choices, life choices, whatever. There's all kinds of reasons for him. Like he has spoken quite clearly about them. So I think that he's very well adjusted to this, and to actually carrying this out and living with that. If indeed he gets a positive result, he says he knows what the result is. Like he feels that there's something wrong, okay? And so he feels that it will be a positive result. So he's prepared for a positive result, and which I think is a good thing. He's not going in there saying, "Oh, I hope that this is going to be negative." Or no, he's not doing that. He's saying, "I'm prepared for a positive result."
And what about you, Kevin? Are you ready for a second family member to go through the disease?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. I a lot of people look at me and go, he must be quite strong-minded because of all the crap that has happened in regards to Huntington's disease over the years, and they've seen my wife deteriorate and then suddenly come back from the brink of and to go through all that and to fight through that, and it was a fight, yeah, okay, I am a strong person, but I'm not as strong as what people think. I have my weaknesses, and my family is that. They are my weakness and they're my strength, but when one is down, like, I will take that on, and I'm not getting any younger, and so I find myself a little more sentimental as I get older. I think that's something that a lot of people do, And, I cry at a sad commercial, I do. But I find that this is something that I'm probably not going to take all that well. There's no doubt about it. I just won't take it that well. But I will get through it. I will. And, and I think that advocacy is what does it. A lot of people go, I don't want to identify myself with Huntington's disease. I don't want to, I don't even have Huntington's disease, but I do identify myself with it. And, eat, drink, and breathe it every day, and it's always active. Like, I'm active in regards to it. I'm always doing something. It doesn't matter what it is, whether it's a post on Facebook or whether it's helping Cindy deal with something with a you know, Cindy Moore, our president for We Have a Face Canada, helping her with something in regards to, it might be fundraising, or it might be, you know, promoting something, or it might be the American Hub, you know, doing the radio show, or doing some promoting for them, or working on their sites, or whatever. I'm doing that every day. And I think that that is what helps me move through this.
And I mean, Kevin, you know that you've got a wide range of people across the country, for that matter. You know, anytime you want to talk, you know you can reach out to them.
Oh, I do. Right? I do. And I'm always talking to somebody about whatever. But they do it with me, too. You know, like I get phone calls a lot, like, and I know that there are probably some people that are listening and that know who they know who they are and who have called me, whether it was relationship issues that they were having, or whether it was maybe suicidal. And I get a fair amount of calls with that. And you know, and I think that I'm glad that I'm able to help. I'll put it that way. You know, usually I can get them laughing and by saying some stupid thing, and sometimes I'm not appropriate, whatever. But you know, you sort of judge the person when you're talking to them, just know what you can say and what you can't say. And, you know, but I do enjoy them. I like these people. And, you know, I consider them friends, even though we've never met. And I don't judge them. I don't. I just don't. I just find them lovely people. There's a lot of lovely people in the HD community. People that I'm so glad that I've met. And you know, and that does help you through a lot of things, because they will drop, a lot of people will drop what they're doing and their own pain that they're going through to help you. Sometimes you have to trust that there are people there that do you know, that do help. And I've experienced that a lot. I've had a lot of that. And it's been both ways. So, yeah. So I don't know what I've left out.
Well, I was just going to say, is there something that you want to add before we perhaps close the show for tonight?
No, I don't think. I think I've said, I'll probably think of something afterwards. But, you know, I'm thinking that for a little short thing, is that once these results come in, then I'm going to need to talk again. And we'll have to do. Because
most
I do,
definitely. We'll,
I do,
we'll go
yeah,
that night.
I don't think. I think that for one thing, people will be curious. But I do think that hearing another person's experience, good or bad, is helpful. We learn from other people's experiences. And I just think that that's what we'll need to do.
We'll definitely follow up with you and find out your son's test results in 2 weeks. And I totally thank you for sharing your story today. I mean, I think you needed to vent a little bit, and I hope it helped. And I hope we can kind of educate people on what people have to go through sometimes to deal with Huntington's.
Absolutely. And thanks, Leanne, for coming on with me.
No worries. Anytime, Kevin.
Okay. You can go ahead and close the show then.
All right. Everybody, thanks for listening tonight. We've been talking with Kevin, the usual host of the radio show, and we will follow up with him in about 2 weeks. And until then, we'll have a good... I don't know how you close the show there, Kevin.
Yeah. I'll close the show for you.
All right, you do it.
Thank you for all of listening to me tonight. I don't want to be a pain to anyone, but I would really appreciate the, I do really appreciate the fact that you're listening, and just know that no matter what, you are loved.